This is video 12 of the lecture on the design of reinforced concrete beams and deals with the ultimate limit state. At the end of this lecture, you will understand the concept of ductility, rotation capacity, and optimum depth of a beam. Ductility means avoid brittle failure, and that holds that the reinforcement steel, must yield. And it means that the strain must be bigger than the design value of the stress in the steel divided by his modulus of elasticity. For BE500, it means 2.17 per mil. So if the strain is bigger than 2.17 per mil, the steel is yielding and you can avoid brittle failure because you will be warned when a collapse is imminent. Ductility means also rotation capacity. If you have a beam in a continuous framework, you need a minimum rotation capacity. And to have rotation capacity, you have a limitation of the depth of the neutral axis. And this limitation should be something less than half of the depth of the beam. So the depth of the neutral axis should be smaller than 0.45 times the effective depth. This is for concrete grade smaller than 50. For high-strength concrete, a different rule applies. Avoid brittle failure. It means that we need that because the sag of a beam should always serve as an early warning system for failure. If the steel is not yielding, then the compression force in the concrete can be exceeded before the steel yields, and when this is happening, then you have a sudden collapse of the beam, which you want to avoid at all times. How can we solve this? We can do that by adding compression reinforcement to make the reinforcement yielding. Rotation capacity. Beams in continuous frameworks must have sufficient rotation capacity to redistribute the bending moments. And the solution again is here adding compression reinforcement to minimize the compression zone. Now look at a strain diagram with the strains of the concrete and the steel, and the effective depth and the total depth of the beam. Then we already know at the maximum strain of concrete and steel, we have a strain diagram which reflects the optimum use of materials. In region 2A, you have the right border and the left border. If we now look at the stress in the steel versus the strain, then we have first a linear diagram and then a horizontal tack. At this point, the steel is yielding. So this is a special point, and it is a point where on the left-hand side, the steel is yielding. On the right-hand side, the steel is not yielding. So this strain plane is a very special one. We must avoid at all times to work in this area. We should not do that for simple bending. We should not work in this area. Now, how can we tackle this? How can we make sure that we are not in this area? Well, if you add compressive reinforcement, then the force in the compression zone increases. And when this force increases, then this line gets put in this way, this side. So this is happening because the steel is not yielding. So because of horizontal equilibrium, if you increase the compressive force, the tension force must increase. And if you have the same reinforcement, then the stress must increase in the reinforcement. It means that this line moves this way. The depth of the neutral axis in this special line is 0.617 and reduced bending moment of 0.371. So always for simple bending, your reduced bending moment must be smaller than 0.371. Then you have another line, which is the line of the rotation capacity. It has a depth of the neutral axis of 0.45 and the reduced bending moment is 0.96. This dotted line is a situation that we should never have for simple bending. We should always avoid that. If you have a section, we will have a small recapitulation of how the different elements of a beam, how we call it, so that we understand each other very well. D is the effective depth. The stirrups, we indicate the diameter of the stirrups. The diameter of the stirrups we indicate as Vb. Concrete cover is C, it's the concrete cover of the, on the stirrup. Technological reinforcement are the blue dots. That's a technological reinforcement. It does not do anything or very little for the capacity of the beam in ULS. It's only needed to keep up the stirrups. Top, the red one, is the compression reinforcement. We always use that on top it's compression, on bottom it's tension, or on bottom it is the most tensioned side and on top is the least tensioned side. So that's just by convention, otherwise you always have to tell that at every picture. Then the clear distance between two rebars, they must always be bigger than the diameter, the biggest diameter you use for the tension reinforcement. It must be bigger than the maximum granulate of the concrete plus 5 millimeters, and it must always be bigger than 20 millimeters. Now, we don't know always what DG is and what VS. Yes, we know afterwards what it is. So what I propose is that we always should keep a clear distance of at least 40 millimeters. If you do that, well, you will never have a diameter bigger than 40 millimeters. That even bigger than 32, I do not recommend it. So this is okay. The maximum size of 35, the maximum is 32. So in most cases, only for big constructions like dams, you will not comply with it. But for most buildings, you comply if you take S equal to 40. And then it's bigger than 20, okay, that is also complying. So I strongly recommend just we take S equals to 40. So the minimum distance is always bigger than 40 millimeters. You should always check the total width of the beam. So if all your reinforcement is put in one layer, you should check if all the reinforcement can fit in. So it's a very simple equation. Now you understand why I take this as a fixed value. Otherwise, it will be too complicated for what it is worth. And just to make sure, the reinforcement for equal diameters is always the number of bars times P diameter squared divided by 4. Just the surface of a circle, the area of a circle. Just to remind you, if you have, this is the outside of a concrete beam. Then if this is the main reinforcement, tension reinforcement, this is the stirrup bar. Then for this main reinforcement, the concrete cover is C. The minimum cover is to the most, to the reinforcement which is closest to the surface. and it is in this case here the stirrup, that's the C min. That's the minimum required distance or concrete cover. The nominal cover is all, this is the cover which must be put onto the drawing plans, is the minimum cover plus a coefficient C def, which gives you the error in placing the stirrups. It's an allowed error. So, and then the effective depth is the total depth minus the nominal, the nominal cover, minus the stirrup diameter, and minus the diameter divided by 2. But this should be, in fact, the point of gravity of the reinforcement. This is only valid for one layer of reinforcement with one diameter. If you have different layers, then you should have the point of gravity. So the effective depth of a beam is always the distance between the extreme fiber in compression and the centroid of the tension reinforcement. So if you have different diameters and different layers of concrete, then D1 equals the sum of all the areas divided the sum of the individual area of the steel bar multiplied by his location, and this divided by the total area. And then your effective depth is, of course, the total depth minus the centroid of the reinforcement bars, D1. This is called D1. The optimal effective depth of a beam is where the maximum strain in concrete and reinforcement is reached. So it means that we are on the borderline of domain 1B and 2A. The strain in the concrete is 3.5 promil and in steel 10 promil for concrete quality smaller than C50. We know that in this domain 2B, 2A, the delta G, the point of the location of the compressive force of the concrete, that delta G is fixed, and Psi, the filling coefficient, is also fixed. We know that the location of the neutral axis is Xi, is also fixed, and mu d is 0.187. Then we have the general formula of the reduced bending moment. If we just take out the d in this formula, then we arrive at this formula, and we fill in the mu d, which is now 0.187, and if we do that, then we have the optimum. So we have the optimum effective depth of a beam subjected to a bending moment, MD. The beam has a width B, and the concrete quality is FCD. When we design a beam with this effective depth, then we can calculate directly the reinforcement, because in this formula, it's a fixed formula, and the zeta is set of D is 1 min delta G Xi, but Xi we know, and delta G we also know, so Xi is 0.89. So the reinforcement is then the bending moment divided by 0.89 times the effective depth times the yield strength of the steel. So now it's quite simple. If you have a bending moment, you estimate the width, and if you do that, you take, for instance, the needed quality for the due to the environmental exposure of the beam, then you can calculate easily the needed effective depth of the beam. You add to that the concrete cover, the stirrup diameter, and the point of gravity of the reinforcement, and you have the total depth needed. You also have a minimum depth of a beam. And the minimum depth of the beam is this depth of beam where the steel is just yielding. We have seen that, and we know that when the steel is just yielding, delta G and Psi is still 0.416 and 0.81. and the limiting value of the position of or the location of the neutral axis is 0.617, mu d is 0.371, and zeta limit is 0.743. So the minimum depth of a beam is 1.64 times the square root of the bending moment divided by the width divided by the FCD. And together with that minimum reinforcement, there is the minimum depth, there is also minimum reinforcement given by this formula. Now there is also another minimum depth, or you should call it, you should give it in proper another name, but that is the minimum depth due to the rotation capacity. So it gives you a depth of a beam where the compression depth is maximum. You cannot go bigger than that, or you should not go bigger than that. So we know this line, we know this strain plane, and we know that mu rotation capacity is 0.296. And we do the same exercise and we see that the effective depth that allows rotation capacity is 1.84 times the square root of. And there is also a reinforcement that goes with it. Now, let's recapitulate the calculation of reinforcement in the at simple bending. First, we take the question or the problem where the reinforcement is not known. This is the most common problem or the most common situation that we have to deal with. The bending moment is given, the width is given, the effective depth is given, the concrete quality and the steel qualities are given. The question is, what is the reinforcement? Always start with calculating the reduced bending moment, because you want to know in what region are you situated. If this bending moment, if the reduced bending moment is more than 0.4 something, then you know it's not possible. So you know that you have to change your dimensions. If it's bigger than 0.37, then you know you have a big problem because the steel is not yielding. So you have to do something about it. So always start with mu d. It gives you a lot of information. And then there are two ways to calculate the reinforcement. You can use omega, the mechanical reinforcement ratio, and you use table 1. That's the definition of omega. And so with mu d, you choose omega, and then you will see in the table, is sigma s, is it yielding or not? If it's yielding, then you use this formula, you take out as, you know now omega because of the table, and you can calculate your needed reinforcement. If sigma s is not yielding, then you have a problem because then this definition here is not valid. So AS is then equal to this formula, but you need to know sigma S. Or instead, we instead of omega, we can use zeta. I prefer this method. I prefer to work with the zeta. It's the same table, it's the same kind of formulas. It's just two possible ways, because this is more a natural way to do instead of this. This is just bending moment divided by lever arm and maximum and yielding stress of the steel. If you want to, another problem is when you have a section of concrete and you have the quality and you have the steel and you want to know this section, what is the capacity of this section? What is MD? In this case, you calculate omega. And from omega, because everything is known in this formula, you calculate mu d, and if you got mu d, then it's easy to calculate md from the definition of mu d. But now, you must check in the table if mu d is smaller than mu d limit. If so, then it's easy, then it's md is then equal to mu d bd squared fcd. And, and you've solved your problem. But if mu d is not small, is bigger than mu d limit, then in this case you have to calculate sigma s because the formula of omega, there is a sigma s now in it. But I recommend that the best way to do is to use the tables with a new parameter, omega divided by sigma s. If you do that, it's just you write next to the omega, because you have omega. In this line, 2 or 3 above and 2 or 3 below, you write omega divided by sigma s. Sigma s is in the table. And you have, at that moment, a new table, mu d versus omega divided by sigma s. But omega divided by sigma s, you have. All those that information is. So you know exactly the value. And with this value, you can interpolate and find mu d. And finally, this is a summary of simple bending in the region 1b and 2a, which gives you the strain in the concrete and the strain in the steel, the depth of the neutral axis, the bending moment, the filling coefficient, and the point of the location of the compression force in the concrete. All those values are valid for B500 and for the concrete quality smaller than 50 megapascal. You understand now that for a given acting bending moment, you can define an optimum depth and the minimum depth of the beam. The minimum depth of a beam is 70% of the optimum. The economical depth is 85% of the optimal depth. Optimal depth is optimal use of materials. Economical depth is the beam that costs the least. And the minimum depth, that's the depth that you cannot go lower than that because you will not have sufficient rotation capacity. See you in next lecture.